Thank you, Jim, for those kind words. Dean Fried and ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure, and I thank you for inviting me to this talk. Okay, I'll go straight on. Why talk about health systems? Well, I think you can't talk about public health without talking about health systems, because in public health, we are looking at what societies collectively do to assure the conditions in which people can be healthy. And implementation of interventions which assure this are an essential part of this mission. But all these interventions have to spring off from a system. And paradoxically, everybody hesitates to invest in something that is not easy to hold, measure, and claim as my output, precisely because of its shared nature. There's a Nigerian proverb which says that when a goat belongs to the whole village, effectively it belongs to nobody. And that's often the challenge of health systems, that they belong to all of us, and in so doing, they end up belonging to nobody. Occasionally, you have focusing crises, like the current Ebola crisis in West Africa, which suddenly wake people up for a while to the fact that if you neglect health systems, it does come back to touch a whole lot of people because they are shared. And such windows of opportunity needs to be used to strengthen and preserve this shared resource. Because by nature, our attention spans vary. We cannot keep focused on any one issue forever. Okay. So the second thing is, why do I focus on sub-Saharan Africa? Well, health systems are of universal concern, and they are global commonalities. But they are also contrasts, because context matters. So I will generically frame what health systems are, but then I will focus on the sub-Saharan Africa as a sub-region, because it makes it easier to relate the generic to context. And it also reduces some of the risks inherent in overgeneralization. And it does also seem less enormous to take on sub-Saharan Africa than the whole world in 45 minutes. Okay. And then health systems neglect can be particularly acute in the less resourced nations of the world. But like I said, because they are a shared resource, when they are neglected, whenever things give, it comes back to hit all of us. And I gave the Ebola crisis as an example. Okay. And last but not least, it's easier for me to give examples which bring this alive if I focus on the sub-region in which I live and work. Okay. So I will start by talking about how health systems have been conceptualized. There are many frameworks. I'll talk a bit about commonalities, contrasts, core principles. I'll talk a bit about health systems as complex adaptive systems, and then I'll introduce what I call a people-centered model. And then I'll talk a bit about the present and then creating transformation. There are several frameworks in the literature, and for simplicity, I'll classify them based on how they bound the health system. There are some frameworks which focus more on the healthcare system, which is the system that provides care. Then there are some systems which more broadly frame the health system and include the social determinants of health. And Dean Friedman's introduction is more of a broad framing, social determinants frame, and that is where I will stay a bit. The other way you could classify some of these frameworks is the purpose of the frameworks. Some frameworks are more focused on the descriptive, how do you describe a health system, and some are more focused on the analytic and the explanatory. Okay, so I've talked through this slide, actually, and the example of a framework that focuses more on the healthcare system is Romer's framework of 1993, which really focuses on nations and talks about the combination of resources, organization, financing, and management that end up in the delivery of health services to the population. The broader health systems frameworks more explicitly recognize the wider socioeconomic and other determinants for health. So if you take Murray and Frank's definition of a health action as any set of activities whose primary intent is to improve or maintain health, and the boundaries of a health system as including all the resources, actors, and institutions related to this, then you have a broader framing. Similarly, the WHO definition of health of alma mater, a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity, is part of this broader framing of the health system. Okay. Now, talking a bit about descriptive versus theory building models. Descriptive models will basically tell you what is a health system, what are its components, what are its relationships, what are its outputs. I'm not going to go into the individual models. There are papers on those models which can be read up. They could take up the whole 45 minutes. It's not necessary. Then you have analytic and explanatory or theory building models, which go beyond describing what a health system is to asking how and why does a health system function the way it does? How and why does it produce particular outputs? And very often, to go to a theory building model, you do need to have described a bit. So they tend to be mixed models. Okay. There are several, despite that there are several frameworks, you'll find commonalities. All the frameworks don't really disagree on what the goals of a health system are. There are three goals which keep turning up. Some frameworks will talk about one, two, or all three. The frameworks also do not disagree. The health systems are complex and multidimensional. They are agreed on that. They also agree on the fact that values, health systems are expected to produce valued societal outcomes. And then again, there is a commonality, and they all talk about structures and institutions. They use different language, building blocks, critical functions, but it is structures and institutions. And then there are the issue of processes, which happen within a health system, and there's the issue of people within a health system. So now the goals, I said there are three goals, which are valued in their own right. There's the goal of health, which is really, if you like, the defining goal of health systems, the health of individuals through life, fatal and non-fatal outcomes. All the frameworks will talk about this goal. Another goal which comes up in the more recent frameworks is responsiveness. Now, responsiveness is defined as an end goal, that it is, it's valued in and of itself, how people are treated and the environments in which they are treated when seeking care. I'll illustrate all these goals a bit more. I'm just introducing them. And responsiveness is seen as an end goal because the health system is a social system. And like other social systems such as justice and education, populations expect that certain social goals will be met in and of themselves. And then the third goal is fairness and financial contribution or financial risk protection. All these goals are conceptualized with some measure of level of goal attainment in the population. If you take the defining goal, which is health, people may talk about life expectancy, maternal mortality, infant mortality. But additionally, the goals are also conceptualized in terms of the distribution of the goal within the population. That is, equity is an issue. So people may not only be concerned with, you know, 10,000, you have 60 deaths of infants per 1,000 live births. They will also be concerned about how is it distributed within the population. Okay. Now, I'll talk a bit about complexity and the concept of health systems as complex adaptive system. Basically, systems are made of separate but interconnected parts. And you can only fully understand a system and what happens within a system by appreciating the relationship and the interconnectedness between the parts. When you separate out the parts and try to understand them individually, you lose the meaning. The other thing about systems is that they are not static. They are moving targets. They are constantly changing. They are governed by feedback. And because of that, when you intervene in one part of the system, you have ripple effects in other parts of the system. It's a bit like you have chairs in a room which are arranged with strings that are not easily visible. You think you are just moving one chair. When you start moving that chair, you start a dance of all the chairs in the room with expected and unexpected effects, okay? And there are certain characteristics of systems which you'll find in health system. There's path dependence. Basically, what path dependence means is that from a common point, systems can go in very divergent directions, which keep changing. A classic example I'll give it, it's a graph I saw long ago. It was fascinating about the US and Canada. About 50 years ago, your health systems were pretty similar. Then Canada passed its Canada Health Act. And the US kept going with the, and over time, when you look at the statistics, you can, it's a path that has kept diverging. And it, to an extent, it is, you cannot reverse it easily. That's what I mean by path dependence. It really affects the direction in which you go. Then you also have feedback loops, which means that an action can cause an effect which then feeds back in itself to modify the action which caused that effect. The other thing, and I'll illustrate this issue of scale-free networks. Basically, in systems, you have networks of institutions and of people. Now, networks can be random or they can be scale-free. If you have a random network, you kind of have it's like a binomial distribution. You know, each person or institution in the network will probably be connected to so many people, plus or minus so many other people within two standard deviations, within three standard. That's a random network. It's a normal distribution curve. But when you have a scale-free network, it's not like that. Particular nodes are very important, and a particular person or institution may be connected to multiple people or institutions, and the effects are bigger. I will illustrate with a story from my work context. I used to be regional director in one region in Ghana, and this was at a time of a lot of turbulence because of union activity, health worker union activity over pay and conditions of service. And in the metro, there was a particular director, the head of nurses in a hospital, but she was also a union leader and very active. And the nurses had just come out of a negotiation with government, very aggressive over their conditions of service and gotten what they wanted. And the metro director decided she was a nuisance and he was going to transfer her. And when the letter arrived on our table in the regional office, I took a look at it. The administrator took a look at it and said, my God, what has he done? This lady is connected to all the nursing union leaders. She's trusted and respected by all the nurses. And because they've just finished a big battle for an issue that matters to them, this is going to be interpreted as victimization. They are all going to be up in arms. That's what I mean by she's a node who has so many connections and complexities. So I kind of called the district director and said, look, you better quickly reverse this letter, even if you want to move her, not at this time and not in this way. And he says, I'm going to do it. And the next morning, even while we are talking, there's a delegation of the nursing union executive, all with red bands on their hands, you know, that they are preparing a national strike because their leader is being victimized. That's an example of a node in a network which is scale-free. You cannot say that all nurses in this network are equal. And if you ignore that kind of thing in a system, you'll get repercussions that you didn't anticipate and you don't want. Okay. Then you have emergent behavior. And again, if I can use the same additional duty hours allowance problems, you know, with the same to work about conditions of service. Basically, what happened, it started with the doctors, you know, back in the 90s, 80s, doctors would earn $200 a month. I mean, that's why most of them left Ghana. So they finally decided enough is enough, we are not having this, and they downed their tools. And then the Ministry of Health said, how many doctors are there in Ghana? Only 2,000. Let's just up their salaries. But you see, they did not stop to look at the system and emergent behavior, because the nurses were watching on the sidelines, and there are not 2,000 nurses in Ghana. There are probably more like 20,000. And the pharmacists were watching in the sidelines, and on and on. And they all worked together in the system. So you can guess what the next step was. The nurses downed their tools and said, change our conditions of service. The health sector doesn't run. And it became, you know, a vicious cycle. That's what I mean by emergent behavior. And then along the line, the non-professional health workers formed a union and said, you better pay attention to us too. And so that's emergent behavior. And then you have phase transitions or tipping triggers, critical points at which radical change takes place. So I've used these illustrations to explain why I'm saying, to understand the health system, you do need to pay attention to this issue of complexity and the characteristics of complex adaptive systems. You don't just intervene at random. I've used a specific issue in Ghana, but I could use it in global health. And that's why sometimes you have problems with global health interventions that are dropped into the system from outside. They look great on paper at the global level. They are a disaster when you drop it into a system that you have not stopped to understand and analyze. Okay, then you have people, and the examples I gave also bring out the importance of people in health system. You have people in roles, people, and the roles may overlap. People as providers, as payers, as financiers, as consumers, as community, as managers and decision makers. And you also have people as actors and stakeholders with individual and group interests and power and influence and ideas and values. And all this interacts. And as people move across, their positions can vary. I was reading an interesting article. I've forgotten which of the newspapers it was. I think it was maybe, I don't know, never mind, it was on the internet. And he says, I'm a journalist and I'm always writing and critiquing healthcare and how much money we are spending on healthcare. Then I was diagnosed with an aortic aneurysm. And suddenly I didn't care how much they were going to spend on me. I just wanted them to spend it and get me out of there. And that's what I mean by you have interests and values, and they vary depending on the role in which a person is. Okay. Then there are also the issues I talked about related to people. I would call, if you like, the software of health systems. There's also the hardware of health systems, the structures, the institutions. Sometimes they are referred to as building blocks. You know, the services, the resources, the information, the financing, the governance. But all these are actually driven by the software, by the people, their roles, their interests, and their values. Okay, so that processes occur within health systems and between structures and institutions. And it's very difficult to draw sharp lines between what I've called the hardware and the software. Okay. Last but not least, I'll talk a bit about context. When you talk about context, you are talking beyond the health system, the milieu in which the health system operates. The context of Ghana is very different from the context of Sierra Leone, even though they are both in West Africa. They have similarities, they have contrasts. The context of the USA has differences from the context of Canada. So all these will affect how things play out in the health system, and you also need to pay attention to context in trying to understand the health system. And it includes issues like ideology, you know, values and culture. I am not an expert on the US health system. I'll not pretend to be an expert on the US health system. But I was really struck during the year I was studying in North Carolina, because I was doing health policy. I used to listen to some of your debates and the issues. It was not too long after the Clinton healthcare reform fell through, you know. And for somebody coming from outside, sometimes that you realize that the framing of the issues are really vested in an ideology that is part of what the US is. And when I go back to my country, the framing of the issues were vested in an ideology that is part of what my country is. And there's no point spending a lot of energy trying to decide that this is absolute right or this is absolute wrong. You need to understand that that affects what plays out. And that's part of the issues of context. It was also vested in the economics and the politics and the history. And you cannot ignore that in trying to understand the health system. So pulling it all together, which I have done. This slide just summarizes what I've tried to say, that to understand the health system, you need to look at the hardware, the software, the interaction between those, the context, and before you finally understand the outcomes. And I've tried to summarize it very simply. There are more complex models out there. In what I've called a people-centered model, which puts people and the software, the ideas, their values, their interests at the center of this. And the people cut across it all, across the hardware and across the context, and influence the processes. And all these drive the outcomes that you finally observe in any given health system. And from this, it also follows that any effect to transform and change a health system is not going to be an easy thing that happens overnight. There are no quick fixes. You just can't fix a health system. It doesn't work that way. Okay, so now having looked at the generalities, I'll look a bit at sub-Saharan Africa. And I'll just use illustrative pictures rather than an exhaustive assessment. This looks at child mortality over time. The data is taken from the Global Burden of Disease 2013 data. And I compare sub-Saharan Africa to the rest of the world. The rest of that's the world average. The world average is the purple line labeled global. You can see that the world average is falling. It has been falling steadily. If you look at sub-Saharan Africa, it's most, and I've divided sub-Saharan Africa into west, south, east, and central, because Africa is very diverse. Africa is not uniform. There's a lot of diversity. Even west, south, east, and central have diversity within, but for convenience, we'll leave it this way. You can see that all these sub-regions started at a higher level than the global average, except the southern region, which was a little below the global average, and they've all been falling. The part of the problem of the southern region is related to the HIV/AIDS epidemic. You'll notice it worsened a bit before it started falling. If you take maternal mortality, again, you can see that sub-Saharan Africa is performing worse than the global average, but it is falling. Again, the southern sub-Saharan Africa, the rise before the decline is related in part to the HIV/AIDS epidemic, which hit the southern African region hardest. So this is just to give an idea, not to be exhaustive. Now I'll talk about responsiveness. And responsiveness, this concept that people value a health system for the way it responds to their aspirations, I can best illustrate it with a real story from a part of Ghana in which I used to work. It's these little rural villages along the banks of the Volta River. They spend a lot of their time on the river. You know, we'd been working there for some time. We got there one day and the whole village was, you know, depressed. You know, people were in black, people were glum. Normally they would welcome you with a smile, offer you a chair. Everybody was, so we said, well, come on, what is the matter? He said, well, you know, one of our children fell into the river and we rushed him to the nearest hospital. And when we got there, he was still alive, but the nurse said the doctor was not available, you know, and she was not very friendly and she was not in a hurry either. And we said, do something, our son is dying. And he said, Doctor is playing tennis. He says he does not want to be disturbed. Anyway, the long and short of the story is their son died. Now, the problem of the community was that we took the child there in a pretty bad condition. We were not sure he would survive. Now, if everybody had been very nice and friendly to us and had run, you know, had explained things to us, when he died, we would not have felt so bad. But because of the way they received us, even though we got there with the child in a very bad state, and we did not think he would survive, we also have a problem with the very reception itself. It's a rather drastic and dramatic story, but it illustrates what is meant by responsiveness, that people value the way a system responds to their dignity, their autonomy, you know, their legitimate, what we would call human rights, maybe. They value that in and of itself, regardless of the outcomes of care. It's a relatively new concept, and you don't have trend data. I just took a bit of data from a report of a key informant survey. I'll not go into it because of the time, but basically, it does show that across the countries, people care. They care about prompt attention, about confidentiality, about autonomy, about dignity. They care about it in and of itself. And there is variation across countries. They also care about having choice of a care provider, about the quality of the basic amenities, and about social support networks. This was scored on a scale of 0 to 10. Then we come to fairness in financing. Again, I'll use a story to illustrate the fact that people care about fairness and equity in the way they pay for services. This is, again, a real story. You know, one Sunday afternoon, it has been a long week, I was resting, when suddenly, get up, we hear you're a doctor, come quickly. And it's like, oh dear, what is it now? So I go out and I find there's a lady delivering in the street. So the issue is, how come when babies decide to come into the world, they really don't wait for anybody, and they don't care whether it's the street or a hospital, or they don't care. So the baby had decided to come into the world anyway and was, you know, on the streets. And so it was like, okay, find a brand new blade, let's cut the cord, let's tie the cord. And I said, let me take you to the clinic. And the woman panicked. She said, no, I don't want to go to a clinic, I have no money. The long and short of it was, she was a poor rural migrant, come to the city hoping to find a better life, found that without skills, there's no better life anywhere, you know. And she was also scared of the system and of authority, and she felt she had to pay. We have a system called cash and carry, where you pay out of pocket. The neighbors got round. In fact, nobody asked them. I said, you get into the car, we'll take you to hospital. We did that. And when I got back home, the neighbors had gone round and collected money and said, go pay her bills and let her keep the balance. And I use this story to illustrate the fact that people care about fairness in financing healthcare. Nobody made an appeal to them. Nobody asked them to do anything. But they just said, this is not right that somebody should deliver in the street because she does not have money, and she feels if she goes to the health system, her not having money is a barrier. If you look, so how fair is financing in health systems in sub-Saharan Africa? It's a mix. This graph shows the contribution to health expenditure of government versus households. That is how much is paid out of pocket versus how much is government financing. And you can see a lot of variation across the country. Some countries like the Seychelles have most of the financing being done by the government, very little out of pocket payment. You come to other countries like Sierra Leone, where most of the payment is being done out of pocket, very little. So you have a very wide range, and basically we are not there. This tells the same thing. This looks at the gross domestic product per capita and the percentage direct household spending for health. And you can see that the countries cluster, the poorer, the countries cluster until you reach an income of around $3,000 per capita onwards, they cluster. There's no clear pattern. You have high household spending in some poor countries, low household spending. And the story I'm trying to give with that this graph is it's not only the money, it's also the decisions, the policies that are made, the values as to what do you do. Do you finance your system in such a way that you are protecting people from out-of-pocket a point of service use, or do you not take those kinds of decisions? With inputs and processes, again, I compare the African region to the global average, and you can see that the sub-region is challenged. The first graph shows physicians per 100,000 population. The red bar is sub-Saharan, the African region. The yellow bar is the global average. You have a 5-7-fold difference, and it runs across nurses and midwives, dentists, pharmaceutical. The psychiatrists were so few, they don't appear on the graph. If you come to psychiatric beds, you come to hospital beds, you come to mammography, it's the same story. The Sub-Saharan Africa has a challenge. Radiotherapy units, again, the numbers were so few. When you do the division, it's 0.000 something. Doesn't appear on the graph. Okay. I think this tells a story I've told already. I'll skip it, and I'll skip this one. So, how do you create transformation? I've not tried to be exhaustive. I've just tried to give snapshots to show where are we and to say that we are not there. The first thing I'll say, I said it already, was that there are no quick fixes. And you need to beware of the illusion of low-hanging fruit. Again, I'll use a story. I find stories are sometimes easier. There's a story, I've forgotten the origins of the story, of a man who's walking down a street, and he sees somebody, it's at night time, looking in the neighborhood of the street light. Clearly he's lost something. So being very helpful, he stops and says, excuse me, it looks to me like you've lost something. What have you lost? Can I help you? He says, yes, I can't find my keys. I'm trying to find them. And so he joins him, and after a while he says, we've scanned all this area. There are no keys here. Where did you lose those keys? And he says, oh, over there in that dark spot. And he asks, so why are we scrambling around under the light? And he says, in that dark spot, there's no light to look. It's a ridiculous story, but to me, it sometimes illustrates some of our approaches to global health. We think they are low-hanging fruit, which will solve the problem. They look good, but they solve nothing because they are not the solution to the problem. The solution to the problem is out there in that dark spot. And we need to sit down and get creative about how to find those keys in that dark spot that we are avoiding. It's a difficult message, but I think it's time we sat down and looked at that message. So what do we need to do to look for the keys in the right place? I think critical is country capacity and ownership. I mentioned the complexities of health system. I mentioned issues of complex adaptive systems. I talked about path dependency, about social determinants of health, about ideology and so on. You cannot transform a system without understanding those nuances. To understand those nuances, you need to work within the system and with people in the system. Otherwise, you don't get it, because it always looks easier standing back. I gave the example of when I was in Chapel Hill. Initially, my reaction was, but America is one of the wealthiest nations in the world, and they are on the leading edge of technology and innovation. You know, America has all the solutions. But then the longer I studied the US healthcare system, the more I realized was that it has nothing to do with technology and innovation. If I can be extreme, it has a lot to do with ideology. And you can't solve that from afar. It can only be solved from within the US. It's the same thing in low and middle income countries. You need to enable the solutions within the countries. But at the same time, you need global capacity and global catalysis. I mentioned the fact that we share health systems. I mentioned the fact that it's like that goat that belongs to a whole village and appears to belong to nobody, but it belongs to every one of us. The fragile health systems in Guinea, Liberia, Sierra Leone made it possible for Ebola to get out of hand. If you had very strong health systems, very good case detection, good laboratories, good diagnostic ability, good surveillance, you'd never have had an Ebola epidemic. But once you had a weak and fragile health system in one part of the world, once you had an epidemic, the whole world suddenly realized that it can affect us. We need to do something. Okay, so you do need some global capacity, you do need some global catalysis. And then there are issues of leadership and governance. And context I've already talked about, so I will not talk about again. I've talked about using windows of opportunity. The world tends to cyclical rather than linear processes. Windows open and close and back again. I always say that the only thing that grows ad infinitum in nature are cancers. Things don't just grow forever and ever and ever. They cycle. The rain goes up, it becomes a cloud, it comes down again, and it cycles. Most things are like that. It's the same with windows of opportunity. They open, they close, they open, they close. So you need to watch out for them and make use of them. Then the other thing is coalitions and networks and being careful about single issue interest group capture. I mentioned the fact that systems are interrelated. If you try to selectively strengthen part of a system, you actually weaken and undermine the system. And that's sometimes the danger of interest group capture. You need to keep the system together. And I'm repeating myself, there are no quick fixes. I can't say it enough. You can't just fix it. You have to carefully solve it over time. The last thing I'll talk about is universal health coverage. And I'll be very quick about universal health coverage because I realize I'm running out of time. Perhaps I'll focus on the essentials. Universal health coverage, like primary health care before it, is an ideal. But I think pragmatically, in an imperfect world, ideals are guides. You try to get as close as possible. And values drive continuous improvement processes rather than a one-off approach. So I would say that, yes, universal health coverage is an ideal. Even defining what universal health coverage is a problem, but you need an ideal to guide you. I don't know if I've made it, but I can answer questions. Okay. I want to thank you for your attention.